The following message is brought to you by Christian Sermons Online, broadcasting Christ-centered messages around the world 24 hours a day. Check us out at christiansermonsonline.com.
Amen. You may be seated. Let me make just one quick announcement. Don't forget, tomorrow afternoon, the service will begin at 3:30. The doors will open at 2 o'clock, so you make your plans right now to be back tomorrow afternoon. And now, let me present to you your evangelist, my dad, Jimmy Swaggart.
Give the Lord a hand. Jesus is his mighty name. Holy, wondrous, mighty and glorious. King of kings and Lord of lords. Fairest of 10,000. Bright in the morning star. Maker of heaven and earth, giver of eternal life, baptizer in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. God love your heart. Oh, Jesus is the sweetest name I'll ever no. And he's just the same. How many believes that he is? As his holy, 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 holy name. Oh, and that's the reason. The reason why I love him so. Sing that last line with me. For Jesus is the sweetest name. Could you stand and sing it? I know you've just sit down, but everybody stand, please, and everyone sing it. Oh, Jesus is the sweetest name I know.
The name I know.
And he's just the same. joining us today, wherever in the world you are, the Philippines, the islands of the sea, Central America, South America, North America, Europe, Asia, Africa. We welcome you to the greatest city on the face of the earth, New York City, New York, where a lot of people love the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. All over this Coliseum tonight, I want you to take your time and don't get in a hurry. And I want you to smile the biggest smile in the world. Let me tell you this. Wait just a moment. Somebody said a long time ago, the New Yorkers are a little reserved, a little formal, a little stiff, and a little cold. They're full of prunes. New Yorkers are the friendliest people on the face of the entire earth. And I want you all over this building to hug some necks and shake some hands and tell your friends and neighbors you're glad to see them. And let's have an old-fashioned fellowship meeting right now. Well, yes, my Lord is coming back to earth again. Well, my Lord is coming back to earth again. Satan will be bound. 1,000 years are gonna have no tent again. Well, my Lord is coming back to earth again. Well, my Lord is coming back to earth again. Satan will be bound. 1,000 years are gonna have no tent again. After Jesus shall come back to earth again. Shall come back to earth again. After Jesus shall come back to earth again. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. God bless you so much. He is coming back. And if you think we were a little noisy, then you just wait until he splits the skies asunder. And mortality puts on immortality, and corruption puts on incorruption. That's the reason we call it rapture. Great joy. We welcome you tonight. We're just so happy to see you. God love your heart, and we want you to just let the Lord bless your soul. And we came to have church. And there is nothing in the world like old-fashioned, heartfelt, Holy Ghost, heaven-sent, devil-chasing, sin-killing, true blue, red-hot, blood-bought, God-given, Jesus-loving, old-time religion. Nothing like it. And we're praying that the Lord will bless you abundantly this evening, touch your soul. Last night, I want you to know, and if you were here, you do know, the Spirit of God moved in this place. My, my, my. I don't think I've enjoyed preaching to a congregation as much as I did last night in a long, long time. But that's the way it happens every time when we come to New York. It's not out of the ordinary. But we welcome you, irrespective of whom you may be, whether you're Catholic, a Protestant, or Jewish. We're just so happy to have you here. And we have but one purpose in mind, and that is to do you good. That's all. That's all we want to do is to do you good. And we pray that you'll leave having seen the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if we can do that, the needs will be met. I won't. Gabriel, come here. Matthew, come here a moment. I want to introduce you to my two preachers. Now, what's your name?
Gabriel.
See, Gabriel's lost five of his front teeth. He got into a little altercation with... No, they just came out. But what are you going to be when you get a little older, Gabe?
Preacher.
What kind of a preacher?
Evangelist.
What kind?
Evangelist.
Oh, an evangelist. Like Papaw?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Say, I love you, New York City.
I love you, New York City.
That's great. What's your name?
Matthew.
How old are you?
Six.
Well, what are you going to be when you get to be a big boy?
Missionary.
Well, whereabouts?
Ouagadougou.
Well, where is Ouagadougou at?
Africa.
Well, I want you to tell these New Yorkers how much you love them. Will you do that? That's good. He cut all his hair off the other day, just whacked it all off. He said that's the new style. They call it, no, he had another name for it. High and tight. The name kind of scares me. Especially for a Pentecostal kid, it kind of scares me. I want you to know. I laugh at Don Evans' little grandson. He's not quite 2 years old yet. His name is Luke. And you can ask him, is he a Christian? He'll say, yeah, I'm a Baptist. And then
They'll say, well, we prayed you through a couple of weeks ago to the Holy Spirit. What are you now? Pentecostal. I'm telling you. Well, glory. Hallelujah. Honey, would you come out here and greet these people and tell them you love them. This coming October, this coming October, we'll be married 35 years. And I know October the 9th is her birthday, and no, that's not right. October the 10th is our anniversary. That's it. I thought of it. I get it mixed up. Last time Gerald Ogg told me on my anniversary, I forgot her birthday. She had a birthday the first part of this month. It was August the 9th. That's right. And I forgot it completely, just totally. We were in a meeting. We came downstairs to go to the service Sunday morning. It was, and Donnie had a gift. Other people had her a gift. I had nothing. I'm in damage control now. That's what I'm in. Honey, greet these people.
What would have surprised me, it didn't surprise me that he forgot about it, but it would have surprised me had he remembered. It would have been the first one in a long, long time. I had some ladies say, well, doesn't that upset you? And I said, no, it really doesn't, because when he forgets to buy me a birthday gift, I just go buy my own. And give him the bill. Now, don't any of you fellows take after that. That's not right. You should remember your wife's birthday. Except at some times. This particular year, I was wanting him to forget, though, because I might as well tell you, I was 50 years old this past year, so I'd given everyone instructions not to remember. But that's enough of that. We're just so thrilled to be here. You know, this afternoon, as I was praying for the service, I looked out the window and I saw people lined all around the building in a long line down into the street and cars coming in. And you'll never, never know how much that my husband and I appreciate folks just like you, because we could not do the work of God that He's called us to do if we didn't have you behind us with your prayers and your love and support. As my husband mentioned last night, it's been especially meaningful to us these past few months to see how that the people of God have stood together and they've not let Satan interfere within their lives and their walk with God. But, praise the Lord. But they were able to discern what Satan was trying to do, and they just knitted together as only Christians can do, and they've stood firm. And the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is coming out beautiful, and people are getting closer to the Lord. Even in the midst of turmoil, you know, that which Satan means to harm, Jesus Christ turns it around and uses it for good. And I thank the Lord for the good that's coming out of it. It's a lot of people that's closer to the Lord today than they were months ago, and that's not bad. And we love you. We thank you. We pray for you. You're our partner, our brother, and our sister in the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, we'll never get to meet most of you here. We'll never get to put our arms around your neck and say we love you. But there will be a day that we'll be able to. And there won't be any time limit. And we can just sit down and be refreshed in the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. We love you, appreciate you, and God bless you.
I thank you, honey. I didn't dare tell her age. Man, that's murderous role. I panicked when I forgot her gift, and I was up before 8,000 people, and I told them I was going to tell her age. And she blessedly came out and told it for me. We have a little granddaughter there. She doesn't want me to call her out, but I want she and her mother, Debbie, to stand. Debbie's, of course, the mother of these fine two boys, too. And naturally, we love them very much. And I've been hinting for a fourth one. I'm getting no response whatsoever. I mean, zero. And so, if you're interested in Bible college, January the 11th, we'll start our spring semester. And God told us directly to start this school. I had no inkling or inclination of even beginning to do such a thing. And it's packed to capacity now. We're feverishly trying to get a new dorm completed to take care of more students. And we have, I think, one of our largest contingencies is from the state of New York. And we're, of course, so thrilled to have some of the finest young men and young ladies. If you're interested, go by and ask Brother Trask. Ray Trask is our president, placed there by the Lord, a veteran missionary of over 25 years in the Far East. And you can imagine that the school has a distinct missions flavor. If you'd like to have some material or talk to him after service, feel free to do so. Ray, would you stand, please? And he'll give you any information that you may want or desire. I thank God for these pastors. I'm telling you, and I mean this, and I think you know that I would. It should go without saying. That's one of the finest groups, spiritually speaking, I mean, that I think we have ever had. And I say that, I stand by preachers constantly. And when you walk over there, you sense the presence of God. Those men love the Lord, and this lovely lady that's with us tonight. This greater area is fortunate to have such caliber, individuals that love Jesus with all of their heart as your spiritual shepherds. And Brother Stanley Berg is one of our chairmen, and Pastor Jerry Stewart from Bethpage, New York, is also one of our chairmen. And I want Jerry to come and greet you on behalf of all of these distinguished gentlemen and the lovely lady that's there tonight. And give them all a hand. Would you do it?
Welcome, Brother Swaggart, to Long Island, New York. And woe be unto me if I should correct Jimmy Swaggart, but this is Long Island. New York City is that-a-way. Long Island, New York, the home of the Islanders. We have no ice here tonight, we have no hockey, but we have Jesus. And what more could we have? Brother Swaggart, you've been to New York City several times, but this is the first crusade here in Long Island, and we want you to come again. Amen. I have to tell you, I had a little dream last night, and I want to ask you a question tonight, if I can, brother. Last night I dreamed that this great crowd was here, and as I came to the platform, you met me, you shook my hand, and you said, Brother Stewart, and in your words, you said, I'm feeling poorly tonight. You're going to have to preach for me. The dream ended, and I woke up in a cold sweat. But standing before this exciting group last night and tonight, it's so inspiring. I want to ask you, Brother Swaggart, how do you feel? How wonderful. We've looked forward to this day. We've looked forward to this crusade, and we've been praying for a move of God. Usually, we Long Islanders go to the big city. But last night, tonight, and tomorrow, the big city has come to us. I wonder how many Long Islanders are here tonight. Just lift your hand. Long Islanders. Amen. How many New York City people? Whoa. I think it's pretty well balanced out. You've received several flyers, but one of the flyers has the pictures and the names of the sponsoring churches and pastors and of the committee members. And I want to thank them. These men and women who have worked behind the scenes, who have been praying for this crusade. And I'd like our crusade committee members, if they would just stand, we'd like to recognize them. All of the committee members, would you stand, please? And then all these fine pastors here that are pastors of sponsoring churches, all of them stand, would you please? How many pastors are out there? How many pastors here? Just lift your hand up. A number of them. Thank God. We appreciate every one of you. Listed here are the sponsoring churches, and you know, you try to do your best, but somehow things just slip through your fingers, and not every church is listed in that. Among that, those numbers that have sponsored this crusade, we'd like to just read a couple of them who were not mentioned or not printed in this bulletin. We want to give recognition to Bethel Assembly of God, Franklin Square, and Pastor Hartman. Also, Everybody's Tabernacle, Assembly of God, Howard Beach, and Pastor Werner Corden. They are among several, and we hope we didn't miss anybody else. If we did, we're very, very sorry. But we want to say once again, how happy we are to have you here. And Brother Swaggart, thank you so much. God bless you.
I apologize profusely that New York City is a suburb of Long Island. I'll get it straight. Now, this is beautiful country here. I mean, I didn't dream that New York City had a paradise this close. I really didn't. Come to think of it, I'm not feeling too well. Would you like to? Next time he said, I like him. I just like him. I really do. I want to take you way back tonight Only God Almighty can change your heart and change your life. Listen to the song. I once was lost and lonely. My heart was full of sin. But God looked down and saw me and drew me close to Him. He told me how much He loved me. Then He bade me to come in. Then He said, if you are sorry, I'll wash away your sin. God took away my yesterdays and left me free from sin. And in that home, He'll never mention them. In a land far away, they'll always stay. In a deep sea called forget. God took away my yesterdays, that moment that God took away my yesterdays. From them I'll never run. I can't live for tomorrow. Tomorrow may never come. But while I'm here, yes, I'll trust Him. For me, He gave His Son. And someday soon, He's gonna call me home to that new Jerusalem. God took away every one of my yesterdays and left me free from sin. In that home of glory, He'll never, never, never mention them. In a land far away, they'll long wasted. In a deep sea called forget. Oh, God took away my yesterdays, that moment that we met.
God took away
my yesterdays. Oh, that moment that we met.
Praise the Lord. Yes, He did. Yes, He did.
You talk about heaven, ain't nothing better than being there. Ladies and gentlemen, Dudley Smith.
Built for me beyond the sky. I'll be ready for that day when my soul shall fly away to that mansion way over on the other side. We'll be on the thing better than talking about heaven, 'cause when I walk the streets of gold, I'm gonna meet my Lord up there at that meeting in the air. There ain't nothing better than being there.
Heaven's gates are made of pearl. There's none like it in this world. That holy city's foundations are precious stone. On that day, I'll see my Savior face to face. I'm gonna lift my hands and shout a final trump. We'll be on better than talk about heaven, 'cause when I walk those streets of gold and I wear my long white robe, I'm gonna meet my Lord up there. Yeah, ain't nothing better than being.
of the Lord. Hallelujah to God. You may be seated. God bless you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Listen to the song and let it bless your heart.
Hide my
the Lord. Just lift your hands and worship the Lord. Praise his mighty name just a moment. Glory to God. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of our Lord. That was Ted Garrett. Thank God that voice belongs to Jesus Christ. Of my Father, he's saying, whosoever will, come on and drink of this water. He's promised to pour his Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. The turtle dove is singing sweet song the morning. The leaves on the trees turn the sill cups to the sky. The silent clouds up there are beginning to gather. This barren land, it's thirsty, so am I. But it's beginning to the voice of my Father. He's saying, whosoever will, come on and drink of this water. He's promised to pour his Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. At that first drop of rain that you hear, throw wide the windows. Go call all your children together. Throw wide the door. When the rains of the Spirit are falling, fill every vessel. Hallelujah. For he who drinks his fill, thirst no more. Well, it's beginning to rain. Hear the voice of my Father. He's saying, whosoever will, come on and drink of this water. He's promised to pour his Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Praise the Lord. Let me give you our people that are here tonight. The gentleman that sang just a moment ago that's a little bit darker skinned than the rest of us puts a little color in this pale bunch. Dudley Smith from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Standing by the side of Dudley is Ted Garrett from New Orleans, Louisiana. The gentleman that's singing bass, standing by Ted from Florence, Alabama, Bryant Cantrell. The young lady that sang so pretty last night, Janet Pascal from Reidsville, North Carolina. The gentleman standing by Janet, Thomas Sloan from Greenville, South Carolina. Young lady standing beside Thomas, Mary Lynn Lark from Tampa, Florida. The gentleman at the keyboards from Bastrop, Louisiana, Lee Haynes. The gentleman that's playing the electric bass, Wade Payton from Hurricane, West Virginia. I like that. The young fellow that's playing the drums, Billy Smith from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Gentleman that's playing the rhythm guitar, Joey Maxwell from Houston, Texas. Extreme left-hand side, Roger Price from Madisonville, Kentucky. One of the finest organists in the country, Charlie Blake from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Gentleman playing the electric lead guitar, Steve Fodder from Belgrade Lakes, Maine. And now, ladies and gentlemen, John Starnes from Atlanta, Georgia.
Well, a man came unto Jesus, who served. You see, he was very much tormented. He said, Lord, oh, speak your healing quick. And so he just did what he said he would do. And Lord, you will do,
Lord, you will do what you said you would do.
What you said you would do.
And I know, you'll take me
all the way through.
And what I
don't understand,
I'm gonna
leave it in your hands.
Lord, you will do,
Lord, you will do what you said you would do.
Sound the trumpet and call an end to time. How can a brother saved by grace know such joy divine?
Well, I can't understand it,
but I know that it's true.
Yet it still amazes me when he does what he said he would do.
Lord, you will do what you said you would do.
What you said.
And I know you'll take me
all the way through.
And what I don't understand, I'm gonna leave it in your head. Lord, you will do.
Praise the Lord. Yes, he will. Hallelujah to God. Praise God. To close out this part of the service, ladies and gentlemen, Janet Pascoe.
Oh,
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah to Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Magnify that mighty name, that precious name. Thank you, Janet. If you have your Bibles tonight, turn with me, please, to the book of St. John. I'm reading from the very first chapter of the book that bears the beloved disciple's name, John. Verse 29. This is the outset of the ministry of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, God manifest in the flesh, Emmanuel. As Isaiah said, God with us. There would probably never be another moment in human history as poignant, as pregnant, as possible, as powerful as this that I read to you tonight. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. I want to use for a subject tonight, and I tremble when I think of the magnitude of what this frail flesh would endeavor to bring to you, God's plan of redemption. The plan of redemption that took everything that heaven had beyond the magnitude of mortal man to conceive or comprehend. God's plan of redemption. Would you bow your heads? Father, we come to you tonight knowing our inadequacy, knowing our limitations, and they are many. Knowing, dear God, that we can do nothing, that we rely totally and solely and completely upon Thee. Asking for the breath of God, the inbreathing of Jehovah in the power of the Holy Ghost to help us bring forth this which is the only salvation of man. Anoint these people to hear, to receive, to grasp thy word. Anoint this congregation, not only here, but all over the world today. Help me to ever decrease as you ever increase. And Holy Father, I will ask it all in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, Amen and amen. Some time ago, we left out of your beautiful city of New York here on our way to Israel. We flew basically all night long. Arrived in Tel Aviv sometime the next morning, maybe close to noon. We were picked up at the airport, taken to the hotel, and on the way to the hotel, we went straight through Jerusalem and got there just about at the time of the afternoon rush hour traffic. The streets were clogged. Having been up for nearly 2 days and nights, I was very tired, very weary. Francis was with me. We were there to do television work, but at any rate, bumper to bumper traffic in the heart of the city. I was somewhat slumped down in the back seat trying to rest a little bit. The car stopped because of the crush of the automobiles. And as it stopped and we were waiting for traffic to clear, I happened to just look out the side window. And what I saw, I will never forget. The tears started down my cheeks because I looked straight at Calvary. There's a bus station there now below Calvary, and the roar of diesel engines were loud as buses were coming and going. The traffic, as I've said, was heavy. The people were coming, going, the streets filled with humanity. And sitting there, I stared, I gazed, almost transfixed at that mountain that meant so much to the human race. And the first reaction I had was, God, it's not right. There seems to be no reverence. There seems to be no concern. Where God gave heaven's best, and the traffic, the congestion, the business. But it was like the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, no, this is the way it ought to be. He didn't come to build a shrine. He came to set the captive free.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
The story of the Bible is the story of creation, the fall, and redemption. The creation of man, the fall of man, and the redemption of man. That's the story of this book. The greatest book, the greatest principles penned, the greatest prose, the greatest story of the human race that the world knows, the Holy Bible. It tells of man's creation, given in just a few words, how that God made man and in-breathed the Spirit into him. And man became a living soul. It tells us of that poignant, horrifying moment when Adam and Eve fell. Somebody said, how do I know this really happened, Jimmy Swaggart? How do I know that the book of Genesis is not a myth? How do I know that took place? No, none of us were there then. There were no snapshots taken of Adam and Eve. However, we can see the results of their fall all around us. The heartache, the pain, the sickness, the suffering, the poverty, man's inhumanity to man. But the thing that stands out in this book, only a few verses are given over to the creation and the fall. But 1,600 years of God dealing with the prophets, God dealing with the apostles, was given over to man's redemption. And that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. Because you see, every single human being in this place, every one of you watching me by television, they tell us this program goes into over 3,000 television stations in over 100 countries of the world. And every human being on the face of this earth is either going to heaven or to hell. That's blunt, but I want you to understand it. Every mother's son, every father's daughter, every human being that lives and has lived has either gone to heaven or hell, or is going to heaven or to hell. So
So this becomes tremendously important when I think of you sitting out here tonight. When I think of the hundreds of millions of you watching by television, you are an eternal soul. You were not just a blob in your mother's womb, a mass, tissue, but a living soul. You understand that? Man doesn't have a soul, man is a soul. There's a difference. The union of God's breath with the frail clay created the soul, became a living soul. Eternity is within your breast. Were I able to look at some of you now, I would see intelligence, I would see power, I would see strength, I would see brilliance. You have been educated in the greatest universities. Your family name is powerful. Were I to look at some of you, I would see eyes bleary and bloodshot, running, screaming for just one more drink of alcohol. I would see the body wasted in some of you right now. You jabbing a needle, trying to find a spot where the vein has not yet collapsed. And society has cast you off. You are nothing but a piece of debris, flotsam. You don't count anymore. Man looks at you and says you're worth nothing. He looks at the suave, sophisticated, educated, intelligent member of society and say, that's the strength. But Jesus said, he looks beyond the pale. He looks beyond the screaming nerves for a drink of alcohol. He looks beyond the suave, sophisticated, intelligent graduate of Harvard or Yale. He looks beyond the color of your skin. And beneath the color of that skin and beneath the facade of the exterior, all are alike. All are alike. With God, there are no individuals that are more important than anyone else. God loves that poor woman in Africa that's involved in the juju, no teeth in her head, she's filled with demon spirits. He loves her just as much as he does the President of the United States. I'm trying to get you to understand something tonight. And beneath that exterior, beneath what men think you are, and down to what God knows you are, you have a soul. It is eternal. It will never, never, never die. As far as longevity is concerned. Now, I cannot understand, I have tried to, but I cannot understand the love of God. I don't understand it. I accept it. I'm a recipient of it, thank God. But I don't understand it because I'm a human. I'm not God. I can understand human love, but I can't understand God love. When I read in 1 Peter, the first chapter, I read there where that in the Greek it says that God Almighty made the decision to give his only son, not expecting anything in return. In other words, if not one human being had accepted Jesus Christ, God would have still given his son to die on a bloody cross of Calvary. That's love. I'm not explaining it. I'm not explaining it well. When we were so wicked, so evil, none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The hearts of men are only on evil continuously. There is nothing there that is lovable. It's evil, it's wicked, it's filthy, it hates God. But still God loved that human race and that human being and said, I will save him. Now, the revelation of God to mankind is progressive, meaning he takes man a step at a time. And I want to try to take you briefly through these steps that you may understand, hopefully, if I can deliver my soul, a little more about what has gone into your redemption. It starts with Cain and Abel. The description is brief, but the story is eternal. Abel offers up the firstling of his flock, a blood sacrifice. He offers up many of those sacrifices. Paul outlines it in Hebrews. He understood, he knew from the fall of his parents that God would only accept blood sacrifice. Why? You see, that's repugnant to many of you that's watching me right now. You withdraw, you turn around, you say no, but it's not repugnant because it is repugnant, it's repugnant because you don't understand it. Your soul is so valuable, it's so important because it's eternal. And because it's eternal, Jesus himself said, all the money in the world couldn't purchase your soul. What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Your soul is on the block tonight. So what could purchase it? Only another life could purchase it because, and that life had to be perfect. So God demands blood because the life is in the blood. So a lamb was chosen, an innocent victim. Somebody had to pay the price. And a lamb was slain by Abel, and his brother Cain offers up a mincha, a Eucharist, vegetables, the fruit of his hand. And henceforth starts the war between self-will and God. Cain says, I will earn my salvation. I will not have your way, God. I do not want it. I want my way. This vegetable garden is good enough. Mister, your own self-righteousness is not good enough. You cannot save yourself. Man has been trying to save himself with his humanistic methods from the very beginning. Because it's hard when man comes and kneels in the face of God and offers up the sacrifice. Now accepting Jesus Christ, he is in essence saying, as Abel said, I'm a sinner. I cannot save myself. I'm lost. There's nothing I can do to affect my salvation. I throw myself on the mercy of God, and I offer up this sacrifice praying that he will accept it. And because it was blood sacrifice, God accepted it, and you still have to come the same way today. You've got to say, I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. I deserve to go to hell. I deserve to die lost, but I throw myself on the mercy of God. And that is hard for man to do. That's the reason the Bible says not many mighty, not many noble are called. All right. I want you to notice the progression. It was a pattern for a person. And that day so long ago, one man, one lamb. Paul said in Hebrews, he being dead, yet meaning able, yet speaketh. It's telling you, you still must have the blood of Jesus applied to your sins. Then, Abraham comes on the scene. Now God is going to give a provisionary promise to the human race through a man, Abraham. He will do so by offering up Isaac. The two mightiest religions in the world hinge upon this man, Abraham. God tells him to do something that would have driven an ordinary mortal out of his mind. Offer up your son, your only son, Isaac. It was to be in the same place that the temple would be built. 500 years, 800 years into the future. And as Abraham draws back that knife to take the life of Isaac, God stays his hand, and there is a ram that is caught in the bush. And God speaks to Abraham and says, stay thine hand. Abraham takes the ram, looks up and says, Jehovah Jireh. What in the world did it mean? It meant God will provide. Jehovah Jireh, God will provide. Provide what? Provide money to you for you to buy a new car. Provide shoes for your children. Provide a house, a roof over your head. Provide an education for your babies. Provide what? This is where the gospel is getting off base. No, I will provide a redeemer. I will provide a redeemer. This was the provisionary promise to the whole human race. I will provide a redeemer that will save all of mankind that will come to him and believe him. I give my word, I give the oath of God, I will provide it. That's the reason it's so horrible for a person to go to hell. A man wrote me the other day and said, Swaggart, he was angry. You keep asking me for money. God didn't call you to save the world. Mister, that's exactly what God has called me to do. I live with it 24 hours a day. I go to bed with it at night. Some nights I will actually feel the lostness of the damned. I will feel it. I'm an evangelist, and maybe it's the call of the evangelist, but at night I will feel it. I will feel that lostness. I will feel that separation from God of an eternal soul that's forever without God. I see it in my dreams. I wake up in the wee hours of the morning and I hear the voice of the Spirit telling me, as he spoke to me on July the 1st, Monday morning, 1985, take the gospel by television to the whole world. Take it. I will open doors that have been closed for centuries. I will open doors to the heathen. I will send revival like I have never sent it before. You obey me and do what I have told you to do. And he said, do not fail me. I hear those words. I hear the stentorian cry. I hear the call of the Spirit. Do not fail me. Is it right that God has gone to such expense that the man cannot comprehend it to provide a redeemer? And hundreds of millions know nothing about it? Is it right? Is it right that somebody brought you the gospel one day and they told you about Jesus and now you're saved, whereas you were lost, walking in darkness? You didn't know God. You were an alien from God. But now you're redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You must want to take it to everybody else. You must tell them. You must send it. You must go and tell them. God has provided. God has provided. God has provided. God has provided. Go tonight to the steeps of the Himalayas. And a woman that knows nothing about God, raised in Buddhism, her husband dies, her child dies, and in her religion she must die too. They tell her, you go throw yourself off into the river and drown. She goes and she stands there and she looks at the cold, dark waters and something speaks to her and says, do not do it. Tomorrow you will see the light. The next day, one of our missionaries, driving, not supposed to go, but got up that morning and God said, go, 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 go. I don't know what I'm going for, but the Spirit said, go. Oh, thank God. Thank God we know the Spirit. Thank God what we have is not some cold, dead form of religion. Thank God the Spirit can lead and guide. And the Spirit said, go. And the Spirit said, go. What am I going for? I don't know anybody in that village. Go. And she gets in her car. And when she's driving, she slows because she sees a woman running down the road, waving both arms, shouting at the top of her lungs. The car stops. She said, what is it? Do you need something? She said, I don't know. Yesterday I was about to drown myself and I heard a voice saying, don't do it. Tomorrow you'll see the light. This morning I got up early. I've been standing on the road and I looked down the road and I saw a light over this vehicle like I've never seen a light before. Can you tell me what I'm looking for? Hallelujah. He has provided. He has provided. He has provided. He has provided. For the whole world. Jehovah Jireh. He will provide a redeemer. I see it now. I see it. John the Baptist is baptizing in the River Jordan. He says, the axe is laid to the root of the tree. The tree that bringeth forth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. And all of a sudden he looks up and sees him. He's never seen one like him before. He's 30 years of age. He's the one that Isaiah prophesied about. The one that Jeremiah called the balm of Gilead. That Malachi said would arise with healing in his wings. That Jacob called Shiloh. And he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Let me explain it to you. Those Jews knew what he was talking about when he said the Lamb of God. Why didn't he say the Lion of God? Because the Lamb was to be a type of the coming Redeemer. They had sacrificed over 1 billion lambs in Jewish history. And he said, take away the sins. They knew what that meant. It doesn't mean much to you when you read it. But it meant to those Jews that all of those hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, not one sin had been taken away. Those sins had only been pushed back for the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. Push back, rising higher and higher and higher. The murder, the rape, the filth, the iniquity, the wickedness, the obscenity, the black heart. But John said he won't push them back. He will take them away. Who taketh away? Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah. I'm redeemed by love divine. Glory, glory, Christ is mine. All to him I have resigned. I've been redeemed. There's not a sin against Jimmy Swaggart. There's not one sin. When the devil walks up to the book of God and says, on thus and so day, it is written, he did it. I know he did it. They turn to the day in question, and there is nothing there. It is blotted out. It is gone. Washed clean by the blood of Jesus Christ. Glory to God. What are you telling me? I'm telling you, but television, you can be free. The guilt can be gone. The bondage can be broken. The terrible weight can lift, because he has come to take away every sin, to wash it clean by his precious blood. He hath provided. You say, why do you get so excited? Why do I get so excited? Why do I get so excited? This is good news. This is the greatest news that mankind has ever known. This is the greatest song we have ever sung. This is the greatest book we have ever read. It's greater than the New York Times. It's greater than the Washington Post. It's greater than Time and Newsweek magazines. It's good news that Jesus saves and his blood washes whiter than snow. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And I'm here to tell you tonight, as you are shouting it in New York City, on Long Island. They're going to be shouting it in Beijing, China. They're going to be shouting it in Tokyo, Japan. They're going to be shouting it in the Himalayas. They're going to be shouting it in Moscow, the Soviet Union. They're going to be shouting it in Calcutta, India. They're going to be shouting it in Bangkok, Thailand. They're going to be shouting it in Nairobi, Africa, that Jesus saves and God has provided. The blood has been shed. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Glory to God. Somebody said you Pentecostals are too emotional. You Pentecostals are too emotional. Well, let me tell you, you can sit on a 50-yard line and watch some man carry an old bag of wind a few yards and holler and scream if you want to. But I am shouting because 2,000 years ago, the Lamb of God stepped out from the portals of glory. 33 and a half years, walked this planet and walked up the Golgotha and paid every debt that man owed. And they put him in a grave, and on the third day, he rose again. The lady stands in New York Harbor, pointing her beacon to the skies, because God has provided a Redeemer. The stars and the stripes float their beacon of freedom to a world, because He has provided. 1 million, 10 million, 100 million, 1,000 million drunks and drug addicts that Satan thought he had. Woo! Glory to God. We'll stand one day at the bar of God and pronounce not guilty, because He has provided. Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh. The provisionary promise. And then God takes the world a step further. Egypt. The death angel is coming through. It's all right, don't worry about her. We've passed the riven veil where the glory never fades. Listen to me now. God said the death angel is coming through. The firstborn in every household will die from the Pharaoh down to the lowliest. But you take a lamb, keep it for 14 days and inspect it minutely for 4 days. Pull back its fleece to see that there are no blemishes. Look at it to make sure that it's not sick in any way, for it is to be a type of the great anti-type that's coming, the Lamb of God. Slit its throat, the blood will gush out into the basin. Take hyssop that grows like grass, pull it up. Slash it down into the bowl, put it on the header and on the sides. Do not put it on the floor. And go inside the house and close the door. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Now listen to me. Listen to me, listen. When they went into the house, they couldn't see the blood. They were in the house. The death angel was coming through that night. Is the blood there? They couldn't see it. They couldn't see it. They couldn't. There was no way they could see it. They had to be in the house, and the blood was outside. Listen, they couldn't see it, but God saw it. You cannot see the blood tonight. I cannot see the blood that's cleansed me. I cannot see it. I'm in the house, a building not made with hands. Hallelujah. But I am not worried in the least, because God can see the blood. 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 It was a lamb for a man, then a provisionary promised lamb, and then a lamb for a house. One lamb substituted for the entire house. And progressively God goes further. You find it in Leviticus. It is now for a nation. On the Day of Atonement. Now listen carefully to this. Listen carefully to it. The Day of Atonement. And I won't tell it all, I'll leave out some of the parts, but the high priest would put on, the great high priest would put on his beautiful garments of glory and beauty. They were so beautiful they beggared description. The lamb would be killed, the blood poured into the basin. All of Israel would stand because it was a lamb for a nation. With those beautiful garments, he would go into the holy place, past the table of showbread, illuminated by the golden lampstand. Directly in front of him would be the altar of incense.
And before he got to that altar of incense, he would pull off that beautiful garment of glory and beauty and put on a snow-white garment. Because when Jesus went into the veil, he didn't go with beauty, he went with purity. And with that snow-white garment, he would take the blood into the Holy of Holies. He only went in once a year. And he would dip his fingers in it and sprinkle it seven times on the ground beside the Ark of the Covenant. And then one time on the mercy seat where the cherubim looked down. And he would turn trembling, because if he made the slightest mistake, he would be atomized on the spot. And he would walk back out into the holy place where the golden lampstand was, the altar of incense, and the table of showbread. Lay aside his beautiful white garment of purity and put back on the beautiful garment of glory and beauty. At the bottom of it, there were pomegranates and bells. You could have heard a pin drop over the thousands of Israel as they listened for the tinkling of the bells. Because when the bells would ring, they knew that God had accepted the sacrifice. But wait. The pomegranates are a type of the fruit of the Spirit. The bells are a type of the gifts of the Spirit. They knew he was about to come out. Our heavenly high priest, 2,000 years ago, laid aside his garments of glory and beauty. Paul said he stripped himself, went into the Holy of Holies, offered up his blood. I know he has come out and put on the garment of glory and beauty, because I hear the bells ringing. The gifts of the Spirit are in the church. That makes me know he's soon to come. Glory! He's soon to come back, because I can hear the bells. I can hear the bells. I can hear the bells. I can hear the bells in the church. And he's soon to come and to burst the skies asunder. I know he's coming soon. I know he's coming soon. Because I can hear the bells. The word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, gift of faith, working of miracles, gift of tongues and interpretation of tongues. When I went on radio, God said, take every station you can. When we went on television, he said, take them all of them. Because we're in a hurry. There's not much time left. At any moment, the high priest is about to walk out of the holy place. Glory to God. When he comes, Paul said, the graves are going to give up the dead as the Lord descends from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds. A lamb for a nation. And then John said, in the first chapter of his book, 29th verse, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Hallelujah.
The world. The world. Hebrews 13 and 8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the eternal Lamb. Revelation 5 and 6, He's the slain Lamb. Revelation 5 and 9, He's the worthy Lamb. Revelation 21 and 23, He's the exalted Lamb. And He's soon to come back. You see, all the complexity of God's plan of redemption is wrapped up in one name, Jesus. That's it. He loves you tonight. Today He's your Savior. Tomorrow He will be your judge. It's up to you. Heaven can do no more. The book is closed. What I've written, I've written. The door is wide open now, that whosoever will may come and drink of the water of life freely. And that, sir, means you. Would you bow your heads, please? Father, we thank you so much. We praise thy holy name. That all may come and drink of the water of life freely. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Now listen very carefully to me for a moment, please. I don't want anyone, unless it's absolutely imperative that you do so, to get up and leave for the next few moments. Please. I want every godly person in this place, I want you to be believing God with me right now. For this is not only going out here in beautiful Long Island, but it's going out all over the world. And as Charlie's playing it, there's room at that cross for you. Now. He's calling you. You accept Him or there is no hope. You accept Him or there is no other way. You accept Him or there is none else. How many in this Coliseum, Jimmy Swaggart, I am not living right. I am not living right. I need God. I need prayer. I know He has provided for me salvation. Tonight, by His help and grace, I want to accept His divine, eternal order and offer. Would you slip up your hand? Let God see it. I will not embarrass you. I promise that. There's a hand. There's a hand all over this main floor quickly. Please, all over the main floor. Now up in the bleachers, all the way to the top, down to the bottom and mid in between. Raise those hands, please. Pray for me. Christians, keep praying. Pray for me all the way at the back. Would you raise your hands, please? All the way to the top, all the way to the bottom. On my right-hand side, would you raise your hands, please? Keep raising them. Thank you so much. Pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me. I want everyone in this Coliseum to stand, please. Everybody standing. With thousands of Christians continuing to silently pray. God the Holy Ghost, the High Sheriff of Heaven, is walking out here and touching hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hearts and lives, as well as the millions by television. And I'm going to ask every one of you that raised your hands, I want you to come. I want you to walk down these aisles, and I want you to stand here, and God will see it. The Holy Ghost will come with you. Angels will come with you. Jesus Christ will watch your every move, because he loves you, as they sing it.
There's room at the cross for you. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Oh, millions have come.
There is still room for one.
There's still yes, there's room at the cross for
that cross upon which Jesus died.
The cross upon which Jesus died.
Come on right now, he's waiting for you. He's waiting
is
for you.
A shelter in which we can. And it's Christ so free, is sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea.
Sing it again now, there's room at that cross,
at the cross.
We're waiting for you, God is waiting for you. He told Abraham, I have provided.
Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
Though millions have come,
oh, millions have come,
there is still room for one.
There's still room for one.
We're still waiting for you.
Yes, there's room.
There is room
at the cross.
Sing it. Thomas, amazing grace, how sweet that sound.
It was amazing.
Sing it, congregation, everybody here. Sing it for the millions in China and Japan and in the Far East and Europe and Asia and Africa and North America and Central America and South America. Still coming.
When we've been there 10,000 years, Christ shining as the sun, we always stay.
One more time, Thomas. Amazing grace. They're still coming. They're still coming.
It was amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was gone.
I want you to look at Brother Swaggart, please. All of you down the aisles, and thank God it's crowded. Thank God it's crowded. Thank God it's crowded. I want you to listen to me very attentively, you by television, please, for a moment. I want to tell you what's happening right now. If you could pull back the curtain and you could open the windows of heaven, if you could look past the infinite glory and see God the Father with Jesus Christ seated by his side. Angels are everywhere. The cherubim are crying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which is, which was, and which is to come." The most important thing in heaven is what's happening here in Long Island and other places around this world as the Holy Ghost is pulling them in. In a few moments' time, right now, Jesus Christ will turn to God the Father and the angels. What is your name, sir?
Frank DiCara.
Frank
DiCara.
He will say, "Father." He will say, "Gabriel." And all of heaven, Frank DiCaria has just come home. Glory. It's going to happen. Every one of you here, every one of you but television. He said, "If you confess me before men, I will confess you before the Father and all the angels, and there will be rejoicing in heaven." In a few moments' time, Frank, and the rest of you, he will write your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Starting a minute after you say yes to him, he will go to work preparing you a mansion. He said it. "I go away to prepare a place for you. Where I am, there you may be also." Now, how do I receive it? It's not hard. Whosoever will may come. He's never turned one away. Never turned one away. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. I want you by television, please, to bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm going to pray, and I want you to pray with me, and I want you to believe it. That's the key. Believe it with all of your heart. I want you to become as a little child in faith. Now let us pray. Dear God in heaven.
Dear God in heaven.
I'm a lost sinner.
I'm a lost sinner.
I'm away from home.
I'm away from home.
And I need help.
And I need help.
I'm hurting inside.
I'm hurting inside.
They told me this.
They told me this.
If I came to you.
If I came to you.
You would not turn me away.
You would not turn me away.
Lord, I'm coming home.
Lord, I'm coming home.
They said your word tells us.
They said your word tells us.
In Romans chapter 10.
In Romans chapter 10.
If we confess with our mouth,
if we confess with our mouth,
the Lord Jesus,
the Lord Jesus,
and believe in our heart,
and believe in our heart,
that God raised him from the dead,
that God raised him from the dead,
we shall be saved.
We shall be saved.
This
moment, with my mouth, I confess,
the Lord Jesus,
the Lord Jesus.
In my heart.
In my heart.
I believe.
I believe.
That God raised Jesus.
That God raised Jesus.
From the dead.
From the dead.
And he is alive.
And he is alive.
Right now.
Right now.
And forever.
And forever.
I accept Jesus Christ.
I accept Jesus Christ.
As my own personal Savior.
As my own personal Savior.
I believe he has heard me.
I believe he has heard me.
And accepted me.
And accepted me.
And this very moment.
And this very moment.
I am saved.
I am saved.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. I believe that tens of thousands of you are going to write us and tell us, Brother Swaggart, I've gotten saved. Our address is on the screen, and I want to send you this little book. I looked through it again the other day. I've done it many times, and I thought I'll write a new one. But I felt I couldn't improve on this one. It says it like it ought to be said. It'll tell you how to get started, how to read your Bible, how to pray, what kind of church you ought to attend. And I want you to write me and tell me what's happened to you. And I'll send you this back by return mail, postage paid. We love you. We love you. We love you. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. While the white robed angels sing that story, a sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam.
Let's give God praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We worship and adore you.
We hope that you've enjoyed this message. For further information and to discover other sermons, visit us at ChristianSermonsOnline.com.